forget it, Megan.
There she is.
The book of love is long and boring. No one can lift the damn thing. It's full of charts and facts and figures and instructions for dancing. But I love it when you has music in it. In fact, that's where music comes from. Some of it's just transcendental. Some of it's just really dumb. But I love it when you sing to me. You can sing me anything. Love is long and boring and written very long ago. It's full of flowers and heart-shaped boxes and things we're all too young to know. But I love it when you give me things, and you are to give me wedding rings, and I love it when you give me things, and you give me wedding rings. You are to give me wedding rings.
Go on now, big man. What do you want to say?
What I want to say? Oh, there's just going to be a freaking night out in the background. Here, give me Arlo. Arlo.
Go on, Arlo. Arlo, son.
I'm all
wee
man.
Wee Uncle Scotty wants you. That's it. There, good boy. I tried to scoop him and I need to... He just jumped. Well, don't we try and keep him in the shot? He does actually look very comfy. It's like a wee rose between two thorns. Hey man, I'm still going. I've got actually a very good camera angle on you. It's actually very nice.
It's very low.
I'm telling you now, it's actually quite a nice angle. Brings out your best features.
What features? This isn't right. We'll talk about that.
Alright, we'll talk about that. Oh yeah.
I just
hate off. I'm not really. He caught me off guard. Scotty, and you were telling me, oh, I crow if you falter at the speeches.
I'll say it. Different. What if he uses my, I can't use my speech now?
No. She can. She just made it up.
That's true.
Right, what do you want to say?
I don't know. Maybe you should ask
Valerie.
Right.
So, I love you both. I'm so happy for you. I really, really am. And I can't think of two more perfect people for each other. And I just, it fills me with joy. Just thinking about it. And the whole day is going to be great. It really is. I'm so excited for you both. Really am.
Loving it, big girl. Loving it. It's beautiful.
It'll be great. I just know the future now will be great. I can't wait there.
Are you zooming out on me? Yeah, big ass is the most normal one.
Yeah, I feel really great. I just can't wait to see this just in the future and everything to come. You know, I'm just so excited for you. It's not obvious.
Oh, wow, what a start.
That's Scotty. I love his book.
You
took a fucking video on my face. I put on my face.
I literally started a video. I'm gonna do the morning videos. Daryl's not here. What's Daryl looking at? Huh? Sandy out of the bath? Crows on the beer already. Mad. What do you have to say to that? It's only. What time is it?
Like, man, if I was on the beer, it would not be that far away from me. It'd be on the hand. Really? So. Can't even. Early morning, big man. Me and you were ready. Everyone else in.
It's true.
No, we don't have our shit ready. Like, we're not that ready, really. Like.
Our shit's all ready, just not wearing them yet.
Aye.
Do you want to give a wee pre-wedding message?
Pre-wedding?
Just pre-wedding? Not pre-pre. Nope. Just pre.
It's pre?
Probably just pre.
Aye. Right. Well, see if this isn't recording, big man.
It is recording. It is recording. Aye, tell me to show you, look. There, it's recording.
Alright. Well, Stu, big man.
And Sarah. Oh. What? And Sarah. Or just for...
I don't know. What do you want me to do for Sarah, too?
Ah, well, you can do it after a film.
Well, folks.
Isn't that...
It's the morning. Each other. Butterflies, I'm going to say jittery bugs, but that doesn't sound good, mate, though.
Buzz.
Suppose there's butterflies near Tommy's this morning. I know there's some on mine. Yeah.
Are you jittery bugs? What? Speech?
Oh, I don't know. I'm sure you have waited a long time for this coming. Remember whenever you were getting engaged and stuff like that, give you a wee phone call over there. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I could just want to wish you all the best. And, I know for a fact nothing will ever change afterwards, you know, and all that jazz. So, you know, just happy for you. And I can't wait for the day to, you know, go through and see all the lovely things happen for you, you know, it's just
but you know what?
Beautiful day. Because I say that dumb word, so I'm the hero. So that's my wee pre-wedding message. Love yous. Don't go pro.
No. Why?
Somebody's
blogging about a fire.
Look at his hair and all.
gonna have to get ready again.
Yeah, big man.
Gonna need another shower. You can't see it, but see your hair, man. I actually swear to you.
What?
Sticking up and all. Did you not dry it?
Did dry it.
Didn't dry it very well.
Well, wasn't that the doctor?
Aye, we were ringing the doctor.
You've zoomed in, how many of you shit? It's close to one. That's where people early. I like to be early, you see.
What? I don't think you've ever been early for anything in your whole life.
Video.
Oh!
From
seahorse. Oh, we're getting a...
Thank you. what this ceremony can and will do together is to witness and affirm the choices they have made to stand together for the rest of their lives as soulmates and partners. And so, as Registrar of Marriages for this district, I am authorised to solemnise civil marriages in this place in which we are now met. Marriage, according to the law of this country, is the voluntary union of one man to one woman to the exclusion of all others. The necessary legal preliminaries have been observed, and before you, Stuart William Edgerwood and you, Sarah Jackson, are joined together in matrimony, it is my duty to remind you both of the solemn and binding character of the declarations and contract you are now about to make. Barry's going to lock the doors now. Stuart, please repeat these words after. I do solemnly declare that I know not of any lawful impediment why I, Stuart William Edgerwood, may not be joined in matrimony to Sarah Jackson. I do solemnly declare that I know not of any lawful impediment why I, Sarah Jackson, may not be joined in matrimony. Do take you, Stuart William Ledgerwood. To be my lawful wedded husband. Now, I meant to ask you to take one another by your hands, but we'll get to that. And you're now about to make pledges and promises to one another in front of family and friends today. Stuart, please repeat these words with us. I, Stuart, take you, Sarah, to be my wife, my partner in life, and my one true love. I will cherish our friendship and love you today, tomorrow, and always. I will trust and honor you. I will love you faithfully through the best and the worst, the difficult and the easy. Come what may, I will always be there. As I give you my hands to hold, I give you my life. And so, as you stand before us, hand in hand, I'm reminded of this passage that I would like to read you both. Love each other from this day forward, and these will be the hands that you hold tomorrow, the next day, and into the next decade. These are the hands that will work alongside yours as you build your life together. The hands that will touch you with love and tenderness through the years. The hands that will comfort you like no others can. These are the hands that will hold you through grief, fear, and hardship. These are the hands that will wipe tears of joy and sorrow from your eyes. These are the hands that will hold your family together and that will give you strength when you need it. These are the hands that, when wrinkled and spotted with age, will always be reaching for yours. You look very generous at that point. And so, Stuart and Sarah, I would now ask you once more to come forward. And together, use the flames from your individual candles to light the unity candle in the middle. This candle represents the fact that the two of you have now united together in marriage, and there is a new life before you. Your separate candles still burn, for you will always be unique individuals, but the unity candle stands higher and brighter to symbolise the union of your lives, your families, and your future dreams and ambitions. And with that in mind, I would like to read a passage to you both from the traditional American Indian marriage ceremony. Now you'll feel no storms, for each of you will be sheltered together. Now you will feel no cold, for each of you will be warmth to the other. Now there is no loneliness, for each of you is companion to the other. Now you are two bodies, but there is one life before you. Turn together to look at the road you have travelled to reach this point, your wedding day. It stretches behind you into the past. Now look to the future that lies ahead. A long and winding, adventure-filled road whose every turn means new discovery, new hopes, new joys, new laughter, and a few shared tears. May happiness be your companion. May beauty surround you both in the journey ahead and for all the years to come. So you will go now this day to your dwelling place to enter into your days together, and may your days be good and long upon the earth. Your adventure has just begun. And now we get to the starring role. So, your gift to one another on your wedding today will be your wedding rings. A wedding ring seals the vows of marriage and represents a promise for eternal and everlasting love. It is a physical manifestation of the promises that join a bride and groom together. The ring is placed in the third finger of the left hand because it was traditionally believed that this finger had a direct connection to the heart, the perfect place for a symbol representing eternal love and commitment. Say, you need your cue! So, take your rings. Continue to grow in the midst of your lives. you continue to keep up courage any problems that may arise and challenge you. May your relationship always be one of love and trust, and may the happiness you share together be with you both. And thus, Stuart and Sarah, and as much as the two of you have promised your love for each other by the exchanging of vows, the joining of hands, and by the giving and receiving of rings, it is my honour, privilege, and pleasure to declare that you are now husband and wife. You may kiss your bride. So now I'm going to let them come forward to sign the register with your witnesses. I will get that done, move on to sign, and the photographers will want to take some photos. If you would like to take some photos yourselves, please feel free to do so. We just would ask, once you take your photo, you may take your seats afterwards.
I'm not going to be able to do that. Yeah. What's the weirdest wedding you've done?
Something. Weird that you're our wedding coordinator because we feel like we know you so well. And
in particular, there was a day, one time, just after last year, my mom and my brother and Jade had gone to Canada, and Sarah and I were saving for the wedding, so we were a bit bummed out that we couldn't go to visit my family, and I went to my shirt to watch Jess, and Barry and I talked for ages. I don't even know if you remember this, but we talked about how I lived there and my connection to Toronto and how it means so much to me, and Barry really got it. I don't know, he made me feel really good that day, and I just wanted you to know that that made a big difference to me. And made me think differently about it. So if everyone could raise a glass to Barry and all the staff at Orange Tree House, that would be much appreciated. To Barry.
The lovely couple.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of that cheers and stuff, so everybody got it. That was a raise. And I know you're probably thinking, like, geez, you just spent that long thinking Barry from Orange Street, it's going to be longer. And the answer is a long time, because it's my wedding, and, you know, buckle up, kids. It's going to take a while. You're hungry. I get the money. To be honest, I've been finding it extremely difficult to put into words how much I need to thank this next group of people, because anything that I've written down on the lead up to this wedding has not been sufficient, and that's my parents. My parents have been through so much in their lives, and I often think how hard it must have been for them to uproot their lives from this country and start a completely new life in Canada, only to have to do the exact same thing years later when they had to return home here with two young children. They worked so hard and never let the world break them. They stayed together throughout all the trials and tribulations that most likely would get between most people. The main things they taught me in life were to always work hard and try your best, and first and foremost, look after your family. No matter how many times these guys have had to start from scratch over again, they've always given me and my brother the world, and I'm so grateful for that. But every time I go to my mom's house, I'm always going to have to fix something. Your phone doesn't connect to the Wi-Fi all of a sudden. Your Netflix doesn't work. And yeah, my dad's probably the only guy that goes to the airport anymore with like 20 documents. But they are the hardest working people I know and the best role models I could ask for. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for everything you've done to help us with this wedding. Literally couldn't have done this without you. If everyone could raise a glass, the hardest working people I know is my parents, Rachel and Vincent. How to do the old lick the finger trick there.
Hello.
Speaking of hardworking role models, the next person that we have to thank today is Sarah's mom, Lynette. Yes, my mom. My other mom. I've known Lynette throughout all my adult life, and she is a true reflection of everything I love about Sarah. I know it's cliche, but I genuinely see where she gets it. Lynette has a kind heart, a warm presence, and a steely determination and perseverance the likes of which I've only ever seen in one other person, and that is her daughter. Lynette has been there for both Sarah and I through the good times and the bad. Times when I look back and I'm kind of embarrassed about how I was probably a jealous boyfriend sometimes. I probably said the wrong thing. But Lynette was always understanding and caring. She always wanted the best for both Sarah and I. And I can't explain enough how much she has done for the two of us and how much we admire her tenacity. The hardest thing about these past 11 years, however, is that I've always had to play the part of the polite boyfriend. You have no idea how many times I want to be horribly sarcastic to you, like, all the time. There's this one time when I heard Sarah, Monty, Lucy and I were all watching Star Wars on TV, and Lynette came in, and she was, like, so confident, and she looked at the TV, and she was like, there he is, old Uncle Obi-Wan. I personally have never known Obi-Wan Kenobi to be anyone's uncle in the Star Wars universe. But did I say anything? No. Did I want to? Yes. Did I wait until my wedding day to say it? Yes. Is that okay? Yes. Because we're family now. I think we're family. Yeah, everybody else said it for me, so it was fine. If everyone could could raise their glasses to Lynette. We love you. My new mom. This is the part of my speech that I put off writing until about 3 days ago. And I do apologize in advance if this gets a little bit hard to talk about. I don't really know how I'm going to get through it, but I'm going to try, right? Cheers. There's a long list of people who should be here today, but unfortunately are not. Hazel, John, Isabel, Jean, Bert, Al, Lee, Victor, Pop Spinner, people that we always just assumed would be at our wedding day, and you really take that for granted. I really wish I had enough time to sit here and talk about all of them, but I don't think I can get through that. I don't think any of you guys want to go through that, so I'll tell you about three of them. My uncle Al has been gone a very long time, and there's still not a day that goes by that I don't think of him. He's such a huge part of me, and a massive contributing factor to me turning into the man that I am today. I will always remember him as the nicest guy I ever met, and, you know, what could be better than that? Remembering him that way made me realize. Remembering that way made me realize that that's what I want for myself. Just to be remembered as a nice and funny guy, that's all I want. And I wish he knew how much he helped me. He molded me into the man I am today, and I wish he could be here. I chose to wear this flashy cream-colored suit because there's a picture that I love of him and my aunt Anne, where he's in a bright white tuxedo, and that's how I wanted to remember. We lost Sarah's Granny Hazel late last year. And that steely determination that I talked about before, Sara might have got that from Lynette, but they both got it from Hazel 100%. And as depressing as this is right now, I'm going to attempt to tell a funny story to lighten the mood. I'm going to try. And that's the story of Sara and I's first kiss. She knows. I had just turned 16 years old. Sara was only 15, right? And we'd been dating like a week or two. And Sara would often stay at her Granny Hazel's house because it was in Newnards. She lived way out in the country, so it was hard for her to get home at night. I know why the hell, like, they lived all the way down in Kirkcaldy. All I knew is that there's no way I was ever going to live out in the middle of the country. So it was late at night, right? And I walked Sara to her granny's house, because I'm a gentleman. And it starts to rain, right? It's magical. It's like Spider-Man. It's like a movie, okay? Couldn't be more perfect. And I lean in, and we share our first kiss for 0.5 seconds. Then Sara's phone starts to ring. She picks it up. It's Hazel telling her she better get inside now. I look over at the window, just see two angry eyes over the lines. I was terrified. It's like, well, that was that. Okay, that's over. Hazel bought Sara's wedding dress that she's wearing today. And Sara's wearing Hazel's engagement ring. And that's when we remember her today. My grandma. She should have been here. Less than 2 months ago, she was picking out shoes that she's gonna wear today. I don't even know what to say other than I wish that she was here. The thing that I take comfort in the most is having a memory of the last conversation we ever had in person. Unfortunately, that's a little over 3 years ago today. I hadn't seen her since 2016. And in that year, I proposed to Sara on the Maid of the Mist at Niagara Falls in Canada. And we spent 2 incredible weeks with my family celebrating. It was great. And as we were about to leave to go to the airport, the time for all the emotional goodbyes started. I really hate that part, by the way, just so you know. It's always really hard to say goodbye every time. My granny made it like 10 times worse because she'd always say something like, I might not be here next year. But you know, you never actually believe it. But the last time was perfect. As we said goodbye for the last time, she gave me a hug and asked me, are you happy, son? And I said, yes, happier than I've ever been. And she asked me, is Mike happy? And I said, yes, and you'll love Gia when you meet her. And she said, that's good. That's all I want for both of you. And my granny sent us some money over for the wedding last year, and Sarah and I decided to buy our wedding bands with it. So that she could always be with us, and I'm just glad that she got to know that before she passed away. And if everyone could just take a moment to raise their glasses to Isabel, to Hazel, to Uncle Al, and just everyone who couldn't be here today.
Cheers.
Thanks, Kurt. Okay, that's the sad part. It's fine now. Okay, it's all good. Finally, I would like to talk to you about the reason we're here today. I think it's really strange for anyone to ever think of a time whenever Sara and I weren't together. We met when we were only 15 years old, through some mutual friends, and I asked her out within the first week. Some people say that love at first sight is a myth, but I can guarantee you that I fell head over heels with this girl the first time I met her. My memory's usually terrible, right? But I remember everything about that day. I know that I walked into town. I know that the last song I listened to on my iPod Shuffle was Rain King by Counting Crows. I remember the first time we locked eyes across the road, waiting for the traffic lights to change. I remember that the first thing we talked about was how you just made a spaceship out of plaster scene with your brother. How can you not follow up with that? I mean, seriously. The thing that Sara continues to be in denial about is that she could have had her choice of any guy out there. This is a girl that is beautiful, plays Star Wars Battlefront, and spare time and listens to Led Zeppelin. That's like literally every guy's dream girl situation, you know? I don't really know why she treats it better like me, but you know, I'll take it. I knew for a fact that I wanted to marry Sara within it was less than the first year of the relationship. And although that may be something that a lot of people put in wedding speeches, I got hard evidence to back this up, alright? And most of you probably realize by now, Sara and I really love the Legend of Zelda video game series. I don't know if that was obvious from everything scattered around the place. And if you're not familiar with it, allow me to enlighten you briefly. Ocarina of Time is a video game from the 90s, which travels through time to save a princess. It is awesome, thank you. At the beginning of the game, you have to collect 3 spiritual stones, each one held within some treacherous dungeon. I've never seen it more nerdy. One is a bright blue diamond known as the Zora Sapphire that was swallowed by a giant wingfish. Who'd have thunk it? Coincidentally, I bought Sara a sapphire ring for her 18th birthday. Another is a mysterious green emerald hidden within the branches of an oversized diamond tree. And funnily enough, I gave Sara an emerald necklace on top of the Eiffel Tower for her 5th anniversary. The final stone is a red ruby which is locked deep away in a dormant volcano atop a tall mountain. And in 2015, I got Sara a pair of ruby earrings. 1 year later, I proposed, and I've been planning that a long time. Sara, you're genuinely my best friend, and I hope that anyone can experience the love that we have, because it's so true and it's so pure. I really mean that. If everyone could raise their glasses one final time, my beautiful bride, this is Sara Ledgerwood. That's really weird to say.
Thank you.
I've been in a buy me a paint and marriage.
What?
Also got a little song for Mom and Lynette. It's okay, it's a good thing. Keep going in these bouquets. Love you guys.
Round of applause for Green Bouquet. Just because I only
only just met Barry, and I love this guy too. As these guys will all attest, I just finished this speech, like, half 11 last night, and I had it on my phone, and I was going to read it on my phone, but Barry got it printed out for me. Big up, Barry.
Barry!
Anyways, for those of you that don't know me, my name is Mike, and I'm Sara's older brother. I just wanted to say a couple of quick words before my lovely partner Jade here buys me far too many drinks and tragically misguided attempt to get me up on the dance floor there. My only hope is that later this evening, if any of you do spot me on the dance floor, a blurred mess of flailing limbs and crushed dreams.
Oh, that's for me.
Please just take a pause and think to yourself, wow, that guy is a horrible dancer. But that speech, man, that speech was great. Fingers crossed. Anyways, it really has been an absolutely amazing day, hasn't it? The bridesmaids are all looking absolutely fantastic, and the groomsmen are looking really sharp. Especially for on behalf of the whole bridal party, I just want to say thanks to Stu and Sarah for including us in their very special day. It's been a lot of hard work and preparation to get to this point. You know, Sarah, you had to organize dresses, pick a venue, send out invitations, get a cake, book cars, make table plans, sort out makeup, pick flowers, handmade confetti with you, get photographers sorted, and probably a million other things that I haven't even thought of. And what did Stu do, I hear you all ask? Stu, anyway, just pretend that you didn't hear that. Kurt Stu probably had the hardest job of all. But it's okay, because I have absolute faith that it will be the most kick-ass wedding playlist that has anyone has ever heard in all of life. Yeah. All joking aside, though, we both were really hard. It's such a wonderful day. We've all already had an absolute ball, and I'm sure we'll continue on into the evening. You're both looking really incredible, and I hope that you guys can relax now that all the stress of organization is out of the way and just enjoy your day. Growing up together, Stu and I have always had a brilliant relationship. We never really fought when we were kids, and some people would maybe attribute that to the age gap that's between us. To a certain extent, that's probably true, because whenever I was 11, he was only 4, and I didn't really feel the need to fight with him over his Barney the Dinosaur toys or his Power Rangers the way that most kids of a similar age would. But I think there's more to it than just the age gap, though, and a lot of it is down to my parents, who have always taught us, Stu said earlier, that family is important, and that my brother is the one person I can always trust to be there for me if I need him. And I know that Sarah shares a similar relationship with her younger brother and sister. When I hear her tell funny stories of horrible video games they played when they were younger, or really stupid movies that they watched on repeat. That just kind of reminds me of the childhood that me and Stu had. So I think that, probably similarly to myself, Sarah can relate to the stereotypes of the oldest child. You know, things like, you gotta look after your younger brother or sister, be the overprotective one or the strong one, you know, things like that. There is also the stereotype that the older one should be the more responsible one as well, but I definitely didn't get the memo on that, because I think that Stu gave my parents a lot less grief and stress over the years. But my point is, though, that just like me, I'll bet Sarah can agree that just having your younger brother or sister around can help you through tough times when you don't really feel like that stereotype of the strong older sibling. And the funny thing is that they probably don't even realize just how much they help you through stuff. When we moved back here from Northern Ireland, from Canada, I was kind of at an awkward age. It wasn't an easy transition for me leaving my friends and my family in Canada. Coming into my teens in a new place halfway across the world and having to make new friends at an age when people are probably at the peak of their socially awkward stage was a struggle for me. Sometimes I would have good days in school where people would love the novelty of having someone with a different accent in their class. And then other days you would inevitably get assholes who would single you out and pick on you for being different. It was a high school experience that a lot of people here can probably relate to. I mean, most people have dealt with bullies at some point in their lives.
But my point is that what I really remember from my high school days is that no matter what kind of day I had, be it good or bad, when I came home, my little brother would be there, and he would immediately be able to cheer me up. So I'm sure Sarah already knows, having lived with Stu for a good while now, if you ever have a shitty day in work, I can attest that Stu will be there to cheer you up when you get home, probably by playing action figures with you and letting you pick all the best toys. Being the best player too when playing Nintendo, because it always gives you extra time on your turn. Being able to recite every line from the movie Rush Hour 2 when you don't have the DVD of Rush Hour 2 to have, but you still really want to watch Rush Hour 2. Or even maybe just practicing your WWF wrestling moves like clotheslines and stone cold stunners and what have you. You know, basically all the ways in which a husband would cheer up his wife after a tough day, right? Well, okay, maybe that list is a bit dated and doesn't quite apply here. Or who knows, having a little wrestle with Stu later maybe sounds appealing to Sarah. That's between you guys. Seriously though, Stu, I probably never really said anything about it, and you probably didn't even realize you were doing anything at the time. But you should know that I don't think I would have coped with that big change in my life half as well if you weren't there being a great little brother. I'll not walk along much longer, but I'll just embarrass you, but one more time you helped me out when you probably didn't even realize you were doing it. In fact, you both did. A couple of years back, when I was living by myself, Stu and Sarah's landlord decided he was selling the house that they were living in at the time, and it lined up perfectly that I had the extra space in my house, so Stu and Sarah moved in with me for about a year while they saved up for a deposit to buy their first house. To most people, it probably looked like I was helping them out, but in all honesty, I was going through some stuff at the time, and to have their company was really great for me. To be able to come home and chill out with the both of these guys, play video games, watch movies, and just have a laugh was a great help at the time. It made me feel like we were back in our apartment in Toronto, doing the same things that we did as kids. The only difference was that now I also had a sister who was into the same things as us. That year ended up turning into a great year for me. We had a lot of fun house sharing like we were in college or something. All these guys were around constantly for house parties, and I ended up meeting my beautiful partner, Jade, who hit it off with Sarah pretty much immediately. So much so that these two were both plotting yesterday how Jade could push Stu out of the way in the last minute, so Sarah could slip the ring on her instead. It's not even a lie. It's not a joke. It really does make me happy though that Sarah and Jade get on so well together. It's so nice that we can all hang out in a big group and always have a great time. That's even if Stu and I have to take a couple of steps back to pretend that we're not with them because they're dressed up in butterfly wings, or recreating the King of the World scene from the Titanic, or scaring the neighbors when they have early nights and put on those absolutely terrifying beauty face mask things. Again, not a joke, all serious. So, I guess with Sarah and Jane getting all my sisters, me feeling like I've gained a sister today, and for all the ways in which my little brother has been there for me over the years, I suppose I'll give you all the raise a glass to siblings who are always there when you need them, and of course, to the beautiful Sarah and her new husband, my little brother. I love you guys both very much. I hope you have an awesome day, and I'm really proud of you.
This is literally going to be my favorite part of the day.
I
honestly, people wouldn't know this, but I've actually known Sarah.
This haven't seen this yet.
I love this. This is just the best.
Yeah. I didn't get to see it whenever it was done. Whenever we dropped it off, it was all just sponge.
That's really good.
It's beautiful.
That's a good
job,
isn't
it? Hey! 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 Hey!
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the bride and groom. Who falls asleep first watching TV? Or just in general? Just in general, yeah.
Who's the better cook? Oh. Yeah, yeah. I'm not keeping tabs. I'm not even keeping tabs of the score here.
So, last one here, number 15. Who has the best taste in music? Oh, actually, hold on, I find like one more little extra one at the bottom here. Who is buying Mike and Gia drinks all night? Well, that's fine, I'm going with Sarah's answer. Thank you.
Let's go!
4 minutes of battery left.
4 minutes of battery?
Oh. 4 good minutes, fellas?
Crow, bust out some moves.
This is the other side of battery. The party is the queue to the bar.
Yeah, it happened as soon as the music came on. There's like just a rush of guys at
that's
the bar.
Good. That's good that there's only 4 minutes left, because that means you just won't be able to see what
big man, big, everybody in this band of the phone.
Big finish, Crow's going to throw his back out before he goes to his doctors tomorrow.
We're down to 3 minutes. I'll turn it off.
No, I don't want nothing tagged. What's that? Don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me? Oh,
don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me? Oh, don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me? No. Don't you want me? Oh,
what might have been lost, but I don't
one.